Oh, Lord.
Just want to encourage you to take your bulletins and read through them. There's a lot of things coming up, a lot of ministries going on and opportunities to serve and to fellowship together. I want to just mention two because they're happening today and tomorrow. Today, at Pastor Gary Taylor and Lois's house, is our monthly birthday bash. Once a month, we get together for all those who have a birthday in that month. If you or somebody in your family has a birthday in May, we encourage you to come out to Pastor Taylor's tonight for a very informal time of fellowship and fun. We have birthday cake, we have games, we have laughter. It's just very fun to meet with one another outside of the church walls and just fellowship together. So we'd encourage you to come tonight to the May birthday bash. And then tomorrow, if the Memorial Day parade actually takes place, I know that they're calling for rain and we're going to be watching that, but if it takes place, you have to pay attention to this because the times in the bulletin are a little off. We have to meet here at church. If you're going to meet at church to be part, if we have a float, and that again will depend on the weather, that we'll meet here at 8:15. The parade actually starts at 9, but we have to be, if we're going to march, we have to be up at the Presbyterian Church on Trenton Road there by 8:30. So if you're going to march in, if we have the parade, you're going to march in it or ride in the float if we have one, be at the Presbyterian Church by 8:30. All right, that's all the announcements I have for today. We'll ask the ushers to come forward so that we can pray over the offering this morning. We want to, as they're coming forward, just welcome you today. Glad you could be with us. We know that many of our members are traveling or away for the holidays, and so we're glad that you're here and that you can be part of this worship service with us this morning. So let's pray. Father God, thank you for this weekend, for this special time to honor those who have made the ultimate sacrifice for their country and their families that are left behind. Lord, we do honor them and we do lift them up this weekend. Thank you that we can be a part of this celebration and of reaching out to the community through tomorrow's activities. And thank you for all of the activities that take part in and through this church and for the funds that fund those activities, those outreaches. We pray that as we give our tithes and our offerings, we would give them generously and gratefully. In Jesus' name, amen. And now we'll have a film about Memorial Day if you direct your attention.
Was those who have given their lives in the service of their country. It's a if you've served overseas or served in the military, you've given that offered that opportunity by being a part of the military to give your life in the service of your country. But many have, and so this is a day we remember those families. For Memorial Day, for most of us, it's going to be a fun holiday, a day we can enjoy with our families. But for those families which have actually lost a loved one overseas, that person's not there. And it's a much different day. Rather than games and fun and so forth, they are remembering the loss of life in their own family, and there's someone missing from their table. So we just want to thank those families and keep those families in prayer that have lost loved ones. And those of us who, as I say again, have served, we've been in that situation of people in our own family have taken fire over there and have seen those die. And it's not easy. But we do remember those families and thank them for their sacrifice. If you have been listening to our songs, there was one word that has come up because we'll be using it with our sermon today. And if you have not identified it, you probably will with this song. So please stand as we sing our fellowship song this morning. Thank you. Chapter 3, we'll be reading from verse 19 and following in a few seconds. Before we do, I just want to talk about a little, ask a question. How many people learn to type on a manual, non-electric typewriter? Okay, not quite as many as the first service. I should ask one of you to come up here and give a demonstration. Have you seen one of these before? What's that? Yeah. You can maybe be able to find one of these in a museum. This is actually a Royal typewriter. Let's see. Still types fine. That was my first name just typed. I learned to type on one of these. It was high school, typing class, and the keys all still work on it. It's great. In fact, we used to have a song that we used to play in band, marching band, and every once in a while it'd be da 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 da, and you hear the bells. You know which one? You remember what I'm talking about? So, anyway, today, how many people still use a manual typewriter? How many people would like to go back to a manual typewriter? I started on a manual typewriter when I was doing my sermons, and I'll tell you, it was quite a chore, because my sermons today, when I type them, they're usually about, you know, 4 or 5 sheets, half sheets of paper, about this size. And I take them, when I first started, I'd type them up like this on a half sheet of paper, you know, and kind of like today, I'd get to Thursday, you know, and think, you know what, that point 2 really should be point 3, and I thought of another point, so let me add it in there, and then I'd wind up, you know, by Friday, not having to, because you have to think the whole thing over again, you know, I'd try to wait till Friday, but then I'd still think of some, so I'd wind up literally cutting it right above this page here, you know, separating this one, typing up my addition, put it in the center, then scotch taping those back, and then taking this page and putting it on the top of this page and cut this page in half so I could scotch tape that one. You get the idea? You know, because every page changed. And so I probably still have one of those old sermons if I went back to it that you could find all the tape parts. Then I'd copy it on the copier, hoping the tape marks would go away so I could read the sermon. Okay, so that's how I used to I started out. Then they wanted to get. I lived in central Pennsylvania. They wanted to get the farmers using computers, and so they offered a computing class at the Greenwood High School. And so I live right next to the high school, so I'd go for the classes and. As you can expect, I was the only one in the class. The farmers didn't want anything to do with the computers. At that time, we had what we called a compact typewriter, a compact computer. It was about this wide, about this high, about this deep, in a white case that you could undo the case, and the top case would come off of it. And then you had a small 9-inch, 9-inch green screen, and this was your portable laptop of that day and age. You know, I don't know, like 25, 30 pounds, I don't know what it was, and I could use that. So I would take it home over the weekends and be able to do my sermon on it, and then I had to get it back to the school by like 10 o'clock on Monday morning for them to use again. Well, I could go on through the whole experience. I've gone through all of the various stages, as you have also. And the changing software today, how many people have gone from like Windows 7 to, is it Windows 10 now? Are we on 10? 10? How many people have made that change yet? Okay, that's a hard change to make. So, I mean, every time you change something, it just goes harder and harder. But, you know, I wouldn't want to go back to the old way of having a, of not having a computer. I mean, I do my sermons here, make a mistake, what do? I just add it, I print out another copy. And it's so easy in many ways. The reason I'm talking about computers and manual typewriters today is to use it as a little bit of an illustration, not a perfect one, about what we're talking about in the book of Galatians as we go through here. In book of Galatians, we're talking about the law and the promises of Jesus Christ, or the promises that came to Christ and Christ was known as the seed of Abraham. And using the law was kind of like using the old manual typewriter. It was an old style, and it was the old way of doing things. It was good. It had its useful purpose. But in the new society, as we live with Jesus Christ, under the believing in Jesus Christ, and with the Spirit, it's a whole different ballgame. Now, there are some things that are still the same. I'm not saying everything's changed. When I go to use my computer, I still have a keyboard. Looks a little different, but the numbers and the letters are all in the same spots, aren't they? For the most part, unless you wind up getting one of these newfangled ones where they've changed it all around, but they're all the same. So the principle is there, but why would I working with a computer and being able to develop my sermons and add and subtract and all this kind of stuff, why would I ever want to go back to a manual typewriter? Only when the electricity goes off and I lose everything, you know? But the computer is so much more versatile in so many ways. In fact, sometimes I even feel guilty because, you know, on the manual typewriter, when I put a sermon, if I refer to a word in, say, a verse in Deuteronomy, I'd look it up in my Bible, and I'd sit there, you know, and, you know, for the wages of sin, you know, and you type it in. I type it all in, and when I finish, then I go back, then I have to type every verse in. Today, I put the reference in, and I go to BibleGateway.com, you know, type in Deuteronomy 22:5, cut, paste, it's in there. I mean, just my typing part of putting the verses in the sermon is so much shorter, I would never want to go back. And so today, as we look at this passage in Galatians chapter 3, and I ask you to turn there with me, we want to take a look at what the difference between promise and law. And what I'd like to do is have you stand and read the scriptures with me. If you want, there's a Bible in the front of you so you can go on, or maybe you're taking your little newest Bible here and out and finding your Bible in there. But if you'd stand, we're going to read from the New American Standard Bible. If you have that copy, or if you're using a Pew Bible, it'll be the same. But I've put it up here so it's nice and easy. I'm going to read the first verse. I'll ask you to read the second, and then I'll read the third, and we'll go back and forth as we read through the passage today. It starts off with two questions. Why the law then? It was added because of transgressions, having been ordained through angels by the agency of a mediator until the seed would come to whom the promise had been made. Is the law, second question, is the law then contrary to the promises of God? May it never be. For if a law had been given which was able to impart life, then righteousness would indeed have been based on law. But before faith came, we were kept in custody under the law, being shut up to the faith which was later to be revealed. But now that faith has come, we are no longer under a tutor. For all of you who were baptized into Christ have clothed yourself with Christ. And then everyone on that last verse together. And if you belong to Christ, then you are Abraham's descendants, heirs according to the promise. You may be seated. Let's take this apart a little piece at a time. And as you know, my habit is to go through the verse and just follow through. And so that's why it's good for you to, if you look it up on your Bible, on your phone, or if you use one of the pew Bibles, to kind of follow through here. Let's go back two verses to last week to set up these two questions that come this week. Okay, this is how we ended last week's section. It says, what I am saying is this: the law, which came 430 years later, does not invalidate a covenant previously ratified by God so as to nullify the promise. So the promise came 430 years earlier. Now, 430 years later, the law comes. It doesn't nullify the first thing. 4, verse 18, if the inheritance is based on law, it is no longer based on a promise. But God has granted to Abraham it to Abraham by means of a promise. So we have set up the differences between promise and law. Promise and the law, basically, of Moses. So we're going to compare. What are these? How do these work in our lives? What's the advantage or what's the importance of both of these? The first thing, the question we come to is, based on this, if you have promise and law, the first question is then, why the law then? In other words, the promise is better than the law. Why was the law even given? That's the question. And so there's basically three points that he brings out in this particular section as you follow it along. The first thing he says in verse 19, it says this: it was added because of transgressions. So in other words, they added the law because of sin, because we did things that are wrong. Would you know that you're doing wrong if there was no law saying you were doing wrong? You know, if there wasn't a rule that said, and this is one of the easiest because it's so we deal with it every day, you know, speed limit 70 miles an hour, you wouldn't know what the speed limit was. I went on the Pennsylvania Turnpike a couple weeks ago, hadn't been in there for a long time, and all of a sudden I saw the sign, speed limit 70. I thought, wow, neat, you know. It went this section of the turn is 55. Now, nobody went 55, but the posted speed limit was 55. Now we could go 70 and we weren't violating the law anymore because the law had changed. But I would have known the law had changed to 70 miles an hour without the sign being there. So the transgressions, because of transgressions, sin had gotten so bad, God wanted us to know what wrong looked like. And so because of the transgressions was the first reason, and that's the purpose of why the law, we have the law then. And if you look back in Galatians 2:16, just a couple chapters, and this relates very closely to Romans chapter 3, verse 20. Listen to these verses. Listen to this one verse. It gives what the law could and could not do. Now, we're talking about the Old Testament law that was given to Moses. Here's what it says in chapter 2, verse 16. A man is not justified by works of the law, but through faith in Christ Jesus. Even we have believed in Christ Jesus that we may be justified or made right by faith in Christ and not by works of the law. Here's the summary. Since by the works of law shall no flesh be justified. So the question is, can you get to heaven by being good? No. That's what he's saying here. He's saying the reason the law came was to demonstrate to each of us that we violated that law. Not a single one of us in here or any place else can live a perfect life. It's not possible. And the only way we know that is because God gave his laws and we violate them. And so that's the purpose. The mediators of the law, it says, it came by angels through Moses. Now, this is a difficult thing to understand, and I'm not going to spend a great deal of time here, but the Jews believed that when the God gave a message, it came through angels. Now, I'm going to share three Greek words with you during the course of the sermon today, just to give some samples, but the Greek words that I'm sharing, you will recognize. The first Greek word is angelos, angelos. Now, if you know of a place that we often call L.A., we call it what? What's the name of the city? Los Angeles. City or of the angels, okay? Angelos is angels. So angelos is the Greek word. Angel is the word we use today. But angel, as you see, is the same word as angelos. So it's not really a translation. It's a transliteration. In other words, they took the letters of the Greek, made it into letters in English, and then made it sound like it was an English word, angel. The word really means messenger. So if they translated, every time you see the word, and God sent an angel, it would say he sent a messenger. When he sent Gabriel to Mary the virgin to tell her she would have a child, an angel appeared to her, but really it was a messenger if we translate the word. But we've gotten to the point of using angelos or angel as an English word. And so they believe that angels brought the message to people, and oftentimes they were. You remember when God talked to Abraham, he went to Abraham, it was three men that came along. They looked like men, but they were really angels. And one of those angels, I believe, was the pre-incarnate Jesus Christ, who was the angel of Yahweh or the angel Jehovah. So we have the angel of Jehovah or the messenger of God, which was really the Son of God, I believe, in the Old Testament, with two other angels. They looked like men, but they were messengers. So oftentimes, messengers did bring the message to people as these two angels did. So they looked at angels being the mediator. So when God gave the law to Moses, they believed that the angels were involved in some way, and they may have been in transmitting or being in that particular mix. When Jesus Christ went to the wilderness for 40 days and 40 nights, it says, who ministered to him? The angels came and ministered to him. So they were messengers, and so they ministered to Jesus Christ. So they were oftentimes in places. In fact, in the New Testament, it says, they write to the angel of the church of, and they named Ephesus or Laodicea in the Revelation. The question is, I wonder what the name of the angel of First Baptist of Morrisville is called, you know? Because it says angels observe worship. There may be angels right in here. We don't know. But they're spiritual beings. We can't see them. But they have many purposes. And in this case, they were listed in the Jewish belief as being transmitters or mediators of the law in some way. The third thing we find out from here is how long would this law take place? And that is by looking at its longevity. In 19, it says here, it was given, why the law then? It was given until the seed should come to whom the promise had been made. Now, if you look back earlier, he talks about seed and seed being plural and singular, and we won't look back at those verses, but it's just a little bit previous. We've talked about that. The seed of Abraham that was promised was Jesus Christ. There were three promises given in Abraham's promise: land, seed, and blessing. The blessing was that all nations would be blessed in him. The land was the Holy Land, which they have back now. And they will probably be there for a long time to come, because I think in the final days it talks about Israel being in the land. The third thing they had was the seed. So the land, the seed, and the blessing. The seed was the same seed that was spoken about in Genesis 3:15, which is the seed devastate the serpent, which was Satan, at the cross, which was Jesus Christ. So the promise of the seed. So when we talk here in verse 19, until the seed shall come to whom the promise had been made, that's Jesus Christ. So the law had a certain longevity. It came until Jesus Christ fulfilled the law. And he did, we've talked about this before, he lived a perfect life and he did everything that the law required. And so consequently, he fulfilled the law. He was the only one that ever did it. So in the New Testament, when it says the wages of sin is death, it means anybody that sins is going to die. And I don't know anybody that's not died yet, okay, except for Jesus Christ, because he had no sin. And so when he died, who did he die for? He died for you, for you, for you, for you, and for me. So that was Jesus Christ living a perfect life and dying on the cross, the seed. So the two questions to answer based on this, the first one is why the law then? Well, because it had a purpose. It brought transgressions. It had mediators that brought it to us, and it was here like a transition between the time Abraham was given the blessing and until Jesus Christ came, the seed. There's a second question, and it comes up in verse 21. It says, is the law then contrary to the promises of God? Since the two are different, are the two contrary? Well, they're not. They amplify, they are different, but they're not contrary to each other. Let's look at the answer that he gives here. He starts right off, in case you had any question, is the law then contrary to the purposes of God? Verse 21, may it never be. It is not true. There are two reasons that it's not contrary. They had two different purposes. The first purpose was the law was given to prove something, verse 21. It says in verse 21, is the law then contrary to the promises of God? Never, may it never be. For if a law had been given which was able to impart life, then righteousness would indeed have been based on the law. Is our righteousness based on the law? No. Based on the law, we're sinners. Our righteousness is based on faith in Jesus Christ. And so consequently, it came to prove something. It came to prove that we're all sinners. That's the purpose of the law. What's the purpose of the promise? Verse 22. The purpose of the promise is to provide something. And in verse 22 it says, But the scripture has shut up all men under sin in order that the promise by faith in Jesus Christ might be given to those who believe. So righteousness can not come from the law. The law came to prove that we're sinners. The promise came to provide salvation to believers. Say that again. The law came to prove we are sinners. The promise came to provide salvation to believers. Let's move on. We got the two questions answered that basically followed from last week. So now let's move on to how do we look at the law and how do we look at the promise? He contrasts the two in this section. And some commentators think this is the most important section of Galatians, but we got some really neat passages still coming up in future weeks. But let's go take a look at it. Look at verse 23 with me. And here the passage tells us that from verses 23 to 25 that we are confined under the law. So if you look at the law, we're confined under the law. Let's read verse 23. But before faith came, we were kept in custody, in chains, confined, under the law, being shut up to the faith which was later to be revealed. So, the first thing was that the Jews were shut up to the future faith coming because they were under the law. The law confined them. It didn't free them, it confined them. Now, I don't know if you've ever been in jail, but what freedoms does a person in jail have?
None.
Pretty much none, yeah. Now, most of you know I was in the military for, I guess, 26 and a half years now. No longer am I under that chain, okay? But I was in the military for 26 and a half years. When I was overseas, we were in a compound. The compound was surrounded by a fence, a wire fence. And I always thought it was kind of weird because over here, you're used to the bad guys being inside the wire, the good guys being outside the wire, you know. And over there, the good guys were inside the wire, the bad guys were outside the wire. So I got to feel like I was being in jail. And if you ask a soldier when he's coming home from overseas what they want, there's three things they always tell you. I'm going to tell you one. I'm not going to tell you the other two. Maybe you can guess. But the primary thing, the first thing they all want is freedom. Okay? Freedom. They don't want somebody to tell them when to get up, when to take a shower, when to go out on patrol, when to eat dinner, when to eat breakfast, what to eat for breakfast. They want freedom. They want to come home, be able to sleep till 12 o'clock noon on a Saturday, watch a movie if they want, and then order pizza. And you don't get to do that when you're confined inside a military base. And probably not when you're confined inside jail, although sometimes I wonder. You're confined. You don't have liberty. You don't have freedom. That is what the law was like. It confined them. It was also a second illustration he illustrates here, and it's in verses 24 and 25. He says here, therefore the law has become our tutor to lead us to Christ, that we might be justified by faith. But now that faith has come, we are no longer under a tutor. Now the word tutor here is pedagogos in the Greek. Pedagogue, pedagory, pedagogy, teacher. It's the Greek word, and we've got a form of it in English. It's the teacher, it's the tutor. There's a couple ways you can look at this. One might be as in the Sound of Music, Von Trapp family, remember them? And, you know, the Colonel Von Trapp, right? He wanted his kids to have a proper tutor, and they could never keep one. So they went to the local mission down the road and got the nun who comes in, you know. And his expectations were probably a little different than her expectations, if you remember the film. But his expectations that his kids would be disciplined, would learn certain things, would behave certain ways, and would be safe. And so it is when maybe a little bit more wealthy family brings in a nanny. They want them to make sure the kids are safe, they get to school in time, and all this kind of thing. When we send our kids to school, we're sending them to a school, and we're hoping that there's going to be a tutor there, not in the sense of one-on-one, but there's going to be a teacher there who's going to make sure they learn certain things and that they act in a certain way. Today, who knows? It seems like they're acting in ways that they really shouldn't be. They're dressing in ways that they never used to. But if you have a tutor in the house, they're going to have a lot more control over that particular subject, that particular person. Back in this day and age, the same thing was true. The rich families, say a Roman centurion, would hire or would have someone be a tutor, and it might actually be a very well-respected slave, one of his slaves, who he says, this person is your responsibility. You make sure they get to eat, you make sure they just get disciplined, they honor, and that person had complete control of that child. In fact, they may have never even seen the father that much. Today, when we need people to take care of our children, we put them in what? Daycare, yeah. So in a sense, we take them to a daycare, and that we expect to be their tutor. We expect them to feed them, clothe them, discipline them, I mean, make sure that they do what they're supposed to be doing at the right kind of times and so forth. The scripture says this is what it's like with the law. The law was a tutor. It was to discipline them. It was to tell them when they were doing wrong. It was to try to educate them on what God's desires were in their life. Let me just get, there's so many applications for this, over the way, illustrations for this in today's life. Let me just do one more and I'll try to be quick about it. But in the military, which I'm very familiar with, you have officers and you have enlisted. In the enlisted ranks, you have the enlisteds and the NCOs. The NCOs basically run the army, okay? Officers are there to say, this is what we need to do, the big pictures, but without the NCOs, we got nothing. Right, Sean? Hear a loud amen there? Got two NCOs here, so I got to tread lightly, you know, as I go along. When you take a when you're a cadet and you're going to get trained to be an officer, you go to a boot camp or whatever, and who is training you? The NCOs, right? The NCOs tell you, they have total control. There's a film, I forget what the name of the film was, I can't think of it, but it showed that. There was an African-American NCO who was training all these guys, I think it was maybe, what's it called? Officer and a Gentleman, yes, that was the one. And you know, and so he's training these soldiers, I knew there would be somebody here, actually that was Navy, wasn't it? I forget, but anyway, training the officers and how they're going to do things. And they weren't officers at that point, so he says, you know, take 12 push-ups, you do 12 push-ups, you know? He says, you go get a line, you go get a line. When I was an officer and was going to boot camp for officers, we had spent 2 weeks down at Fort Dix with the NCOs. And we'd go there, and I'd go for lunch, or for a meal, and you stand at attention, you're in line for the meal. Then the guy in front of you move, you'd go to at ease, you'd go from at ease to attention, you'd walk up one step, you go back to at ease. And you wait, next guy moves up, you go up, how to do it. If he caught you not doing it, give me push-ups, sir. You know, I'm an officer, but you had to do it. And God forbid that you would not do what they told you to do, because you were being tutored on how to do things right. And like an officer and a gentleman, when the cadet or the trainee officer gets to be an officer, there comes the day when he gets promoted and he pins on his second lieutenant bars, say if it's in the army. And he comes up there and it was so neat because he gets pinned and then he walks over to the NCO who had been training the whole time, and the NCO says, congratulations, sir. Now he recognizes he's been promoted. Now he's an officer. And the relationship completely changes. And so it is with us in the law. We're under the law, and we're being tutored by the law, and it's telling us we're doing a rotten job of doing what we're supposed to be doing because we're sinners. But it's teaching us, and it's leading us to God. And when we come to the place of growing up and becoming as in my illustration, an officer, or an adult child, we're no longer under the discipline of that tutor or that nanny. We are now on our own. Now, when I became an officer, there were certain things I had was expected of me. Did I, once I became an officer, say, oh, now I can become a fat slob? Now I can wear my things out, you know? God forbid. We were kidding about this the other day. I talked to Sean, I'm, you know, about wearing a uniform tomorrow. He says, well, you'll be fine as long as you're dressed properly, or I will tell you how to dress properly. Because that's what an NCO does, you know? He makes sure you have the uniform right on you, because that's their job. But I hope never to be corrected by an NCO. I want to work, so I'm doing the right job all the time, okay? So as a person grows up, and whether you become an officer, whether you become a grown-up adult, my point is you don't change necessarily the way you've been acting before. It's not just say, oh, now I'm under the law, so now I'm going to go get high, I'm going to do drugs, I'm going to crack the car, I'm going to drive drunk. No. If you've been trained as a young person to walk in a certain way, now you're free. Now you get to do what you want. But hopefully the tutoring and the teaching you've had will give you the proper direction to be an adequate adult or officer or whatever other part you might be in life. And so it is when we look here. It says we are under the law. But when we become a Christian and the promise comes and we know that Jesus Christ has come and paid for our sins and we by faith accept him as our personal Savior, while before the Jews were under the law, now why are these Judaizers coming along trying to say, obey the law? The law was done. It was a tutor. It did its job. Now it's finished. Now we're under the promise of Abraham. Because righteousness does not come by keeping the law. Righteousness comes by our faith in Jesus Christ. And that's the only way I can tell you I'm going to heaven. Because if I was still under the law, well, I know I'd be headed to hell. I wouldn't have to worry about it. But if I had to worry about how I'm living in order to stay saved, did I make a mistake today that was bad enough to lose my salvation? I'd have to ask that question. But I do not need to ask that question if I'm going to heaven based on the promise of what Jesus Christ did for me on the cross. Amen?
Amen.
So as we look at this section, the two examples say that the law is confining, whether it's by a prison, being in custody, or whether it's by being under a tutor. But now we are free under the promise, and that's verses 26 through 29. He tells us four things in here. Let's take a look at them. Verse 26. We are free under the promise because, one, for you are all sons of God through faith in Christ Jesus. Now, in some languages like Spanish, nouns are either masculine or feminine. Okay, and any pronoun or other type of modifier needs to match that particular gender of that particular noun. We don't have that in English. They do in Greek. Here it says sons of God. Because of the way Spanish is, sometimes if you're talking about, say, let's talk about men and women, there's sometimes a neutral version to use, or sometimes you just use the masculine to refer to both men and women. The question is here, does it mean children of God or sons of God? And children of God is the way we would generally define it, but a commentator mentioned a very good point that I think is serious to be considered. In the day and age in which Paul was writing this, who received the inheritance of a family? The first son. The first son did. The second and third son oftentimes did not get something, or was split between the sons and the women got nothing. In the Old Testament, the land was handed down through the male descendants of the particular father, which is why Abraham, though he had no descendants, was really concerned that he have a son. When Abraham had a son, that was handed down to him. Later on, there was a family that had five daughters in Joshua's time, but no son. One of the daughters came and said, if only men can inherit land, then our entire father's inheritance will die with us and will go to one of his brothers, and there will be no more chance of our descendants having his land. So they made a special rule that if they married within their particular tribe, that the land would stay in their family and they could inherit down through there. I bring that up only to say that it may be valid of consideration to think that he really means sons of God, because he wants everybody to realize that regardless of your sex, regardless of your race, regardless of your age, if you receive the promise through Abraham, you are an heir. You get everything that's there. And since the first son got everything, to call us sons of God is to say that every one of us with faith in Jesus Christ gets it all. And so I think that whether you want to translate it children, which is fine, and it still makes sense, but if you want to make sons, I think the purpose is that we're all positionally sons before God. We get the full inheritance of everything there is. The second part we look here is that it says in verse 27, "For all of you who were baptized into Christ have clothed yourself with Christ." Now the question is, is this talking about water baptism? Or about spirit baptism? My preference is, I think, is talking about spirit baptism, but it can apply to both, because both spirit baptism and water baptism are very much interrelated. Let me go back to those three Greek words I talked to you about, okay? We already talked about two of them. Angelos, remember? Angel, pedagogy. Here's the third one. Baptizo is the Greek word. The word used here is baptize. Baptize is not a translation. It's what we call, like the other two, a transliteration. They take the Greek letter and they make the English letter, Greek letter, English letter, Greek letter, English letter, and then take the resulting word, baptizo, and make it sound like it's an English word by saying baptize. And so we have no idea what it means. We just know that it's baptizo. If they had translated it the way it really meant, it would say immersion or placed into. Because the word baptizo means to place into. So consequently, look here, it says you're all baptized. If you're baptized with Christ and into the body of Christ, it means we're placed into the body of Christ. We're not poured on the body of Christ. We're not sprinkled on the body of Christ. We're placed into the body of Christ. And so spirit baptism places us into the body of Christ at large with all other believers. Water baptism places us into the local body of Christ because it can be seen. Can I see you getting spirit baptized? Probably not. You know, I mean, it's not like when you get saved, they see a tongue of fire coming down on your head or doves surrounding or anything. I mean, there's no physical, obvious reason to say you got baptized with the Spirit into the body of Christ. In the early church, a few times that happened because it had never been done before. And God wanted to make sure the Jews and the Gentiles observing it knew what was taking place. But today you don't see that. So how do we say, I got baptized with the Spirit, which is another word saying, I got saved? Well, by going through the waters of baptism. So that's the public way in which we demonstrate that we're baptized. Now, let me marry this verse up with 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 13. If you want to look at it, it says this: "For by one Spirit we were all baptized into one body, whether Jews or Greeks, whether slaves or free, and we were all made to drink of one Spirit." The only way that he could, and here you have spirit baptism, water baptism related, the only way you could say that everyone was baptized by the Spirit is if it happened at the moment of salvation. Consequently, if you're saved, if you receive the promise, you're baptized by the Spirit. You're placed, in other words, placed into the body of Christ. So if someone tells you, once you're saved, you need to do something else, whether it's jump in a lake or even get baptized by water or speak in tongues or whatever it happens to be, it's adding on to what this says, because this tells us that we're all baptized by the Spirit into one body. This verse joined with 1 Corinthians. And so that's part of the promise. Such was not true in the Old Testament. If you read about King David, King Saul, he got the Spirit, and then he went his own way, and God withdrew his Spirit from him. And then he gave his Spirit to King David. The Spirit came and went in the Old Testament as people needed it to serve God. Here, in the New Testament times, we all receive the Spirit. And so we find we're all sons, we're all baptized, and then if you look at verse 28, we're all one. There's neither Jew nor Greek. There's neither slave nor free. There's neither male nor female, for you are all one in Christ. Our standing before Christ does not depend on our gender status, on our physical status, on our weight, on our whether we're slave or free, or our economic status. It says we are all one in Christ, and we stand before Him as on the same level. It's not like some people are better than others. We still need to observe that we got to follow Christ. But for all believers who follow Jesus Christ and obey Him, we stand before Him regardless of our race, regardless of our size, regardless of our gender. We are one before Christ. Now, mind you, this does not mean that we erase all these specifics. It doesn't mean that the person in Paul's days talking to him, he was a slave, he was no longer a slave. No, it means before Christ, he was the same as a free man. They were parallel before God. But yet, when they went home, they might still be in a slave status. And Paul actually didn't, in this passage, say they shouldn't be slaves. He said they should be good slaves, good Christian slaves. So he didn't nullify what takes place. He just says that it doesn't matter when we stand before God and we're people with a promise. I think today, and of course you go, I'm maybe stepping on a little bit of dangerous ground here with some, but you know, today Satan wants to see the church and the family destroyed. And so some of this he is trying to break down, and particularly between the sexes, the male and female. He's trying to say there is no more male and female. He's using that as a wedge to come into families and to come into churches. I mean, after all, if people of the same gender get married, there's going to be no more creation. There's going to be no more kids. He's going to break up the family unit. And if people that are not like that, that are not of heterosexual, get married and have children, is going to be able to destroy what we consider the family unit. The same thing's happening in the church today. We get into the church today, this issue is getting into the church, and some people are saying, oh, we can have homosexual pastors. And that's great. But they're ignoring the scriptures. Even in the last couple of weeks, we have this transgender thing coming up with bathrooms and everything else like that. I'm telling you that just because the Bible says we are right before God and we're all equal does not mean that all changes between us are wiped out. There's a scripture, let me just read this. There's this one verse in Deuteronomy chapter 22. It says, a woman shall not wear a man's clothing, nor shall a man put on woman's clothing, for whoever does these things is an abomination to the Lord your God. And the law, which is this part of, is giving us as a tutor. It's telling us this is sin. This is what you should not be doing. As we come under the promise, we now follow these not because it's a law, but because we know it's right and wrong. And so we need to make sure that we are not allowing the outside world to change what the church is in the sense of following what God says we should do. He did not wipe out the Old Testament law. He fulfilled the Old Testament law. So we are all sons. We're all baptized. We're all one. And then lastly, and this is kind of the caveat to all these coming together, we are all heirs. It says in Romans 8:17, if children, then heirs, heirs of God, and fellow heirs with Christ. So in other words, since we have the same standing before God, the right standing before God, that means we are all heirs of the promise. And what's the promise? Eternal life in heaven with God. And so the question today that we need to ask us ourselves is, are you still under the law or are you under the promise? Are you still under the law and trying to be good to get to heaven? If I were to ask you if you should die right this second and God would ask you, why should I let you into my heaven, what would you say? Many people that I ask that question to say, well, I'm trying to do my best. I'm trying to be as good as I can. But if they understand Galatians, being good enough doesn't cut it, because nobody is good, it says in Romans, none is righteous, not even one. I'm a preacher. I grew up in a preacher's family. And I'm not saying this to be a goody two-shoes, but just tell you, because of my upbringing, I've never done drugs, I've never smoked a cigarette, I've not been a drinker, all these kind of things. So I guess I've never been arrested. You know, what I'm trying to say is that I'm a sinner headed to hell. And the preacher with that kind of a pedigree is a sinner headed to hell. What chance is anybody else? That's what Paul went through. He said, I'm an Israelite of Israelites. I was a Pharisee beyond, without any proud. He gave all the things that he had done good. But yet it was not enough to get him to heaven. And I'm telling you that the only way to get to heaven is not by keeping the law, but it's by believing in Jesus Christ, who is the promise. If you do that, you can be sure of getting to heaven. And then as you live your life, you're living it free under the promise and not confined under the law. As we close this morning, you'll notice that the final thing on your notes there that I'd like you to remember is that the scriptures or the law was a tutor to lead us to Christ. It was not to confine us. It was not to try to save us, but it was a tutor simply to tell us how to come to Jesus Christ. The way to come to Jesus Christ is to, one, recognize your sin. Recognize you're a sinner. Can't get past that. Then recognize that Jesus Christ was not a sinner. He lived a perfect life and he died on the cross. And then the third point is so important, because so many people say, oh yeah, I'm probably a sinner. Yeah, Jesus Christ died for me. But it's got to be a personal commitment on your behalf. I believe this and I accept what Jesus Christ did on the cross. If I pulled a $100 bill out of my pocket, and I don't have a $100 bill in my pocket, and I said, this is yours. Is it yours? When does it become yours? When you walk up and take it out of my hand. And so it is for salvation. You can believe all you want about salvation as far as knowing that it exists and say, oh, it's there, and yeah, it might be true. But until you make a personal reception of it, it is meaningless. I hope today is the day that you stand on the promises as we sang at the fellowship time, and that you take a personal faith and trust in Jesus Christ. As you go out this week, don't go out thinking, I'm under the law, and boy, am I going to be good enough to get to heaven? Thinking, I'm saved by grace, and praise God for that. Dear Lord, we thank you for your salvation. We thank you for Jesus Christ dying on the cross. We pray that today, if there's anyone here that does not know you as a personal Savior, that they might talk to someone before they leave and get that assurance that you live in our hearts and you'll take us to heaven. We thank you for the freedom we have in Jesus Christ, and we ask that you might just help us to live in that freedom this week and to be confident that one day, regardless of what happens this week, we'll be together in heaven with you and your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. Please stand as we sing our final song this morning. This song evidences what it's all about, trusting Jesus.
It's so sweet to trust in Jesus, just to take him at his word, just to rest upon his promise, just to know the Savior. Jesus, precious Jesus, trust him, how I've proved him o'er and o'er. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him more.
Dear Lord, as we go this day, we ask that you just might watch over us. We thank you for your grace in our lives. Bless us this weekend, and especially those families who have lost loved ones in the service of their country. May you give them a special blessing this weekend. In Jesus' name, amen.
At my feet, and